Is that time?
Good morning.
Broadcasting on 200,000 watts of talk power.
The radio is like your kingdom.
You're waking up with the face of radio. Henry Hinton.
That was what we call in radio lingo, audio gold.
This is Talk of the Town with Henry Hinton on Talk 96.3 and 103.7.
Welcome back, Hour 2. I normally do not open someone else's mail, but this was laying on one of the desks here in the studio this morning. You see this?
I did. I didn't know what it was until you opened
Farmer's
it.
It's a Farmer's Almanac, and it was addressed to Sadie. And, of course, Sadie is no longer with us, and so I don't have a forwarding address, so I just opened it myself. Yeah. I knew if I thought it was a personal letter, I wouldn't have opened it, but I knew it was it said on the outside because of the envelope, it was a Farmer's Almanac, yes. So I wanted to see what it was saying about. I've got to flip through this a little bit and see what's coming up. I'm looking to see if it says anything about it. It's got a lot of predictions for 2021, but I don't see anything yet about COVID. I don't know if the Farmer's Almanac is good at predicting COVID. They're also not good at predicting the weather, but they always claim to. So I'll dig into the Farmer's Almanac. By the way, it's a lot smaller than it used to. I remember when I was a kid, we used to get the Farmer's Almanac, and this looks like this is more like the farmer's pamphlet.
Mandy Cohen made a prediction for 2021 about COVID-19.
Yeah, I just saw that. What's she saying?
And I'm just
Mandy Cohen. That's who we want to hear make
a
prediction.
She said that she expects the virus situation to continue, perhaps through mid 2021.
God, I hope not. We just got to get rid of this thing, don't we?
Yes.
Well, we
got
to learn how to live with it. I mean, it's just nuts, nuts. We've been talking about a lot this morning. I don't want to harp on it, but we got a phone call here that wants to respond to this. This guy that's on the State Board of Education, James Ford from Charlotte, who tweeted last week during the Democrat National Convention. Of course, the Republican National Convention starts today in Charlotte. But the James Ford tweeted last week that he couldn't watch the DNC because the Democrat Party was catering to swing voters who were white supremacists. And so many people calling for his resignation, everybody at the high state level, including the State Board of Education Superintendent Mark Johnson, the candidate we had in here last week, Catherine Pruitt, said he should resign.
Pruitt.
Catherine Pruitt, I'm sorry. Former chancellor moment.
Still me used. Thank you. Thank you, Herman.
He has doubled down on it in an article on ednc.org, which is probably some arm of the NCAE or something, by saying that I always entered the space of an educator with the orientation of an activist. It was never born out of good intentions or to say, oh, I just want to give back or I just really love kids. I had a mission in mind. The way that I wielded my curriculum was to interrogate current events and issues of the past through a lens that, one, develops my students' critical thinking, and, two, to really talk about and focus on systems of power. So, you know, you got this guy who was the 2014 Teacher of the Year for the state of North Carolina who says, I didn't get into teaching to do good. I got into teaching to try to indoctrinate the children and my students into thinking the way that I think. And I think that white people are white supremacists. So, you know, it just blows your mind. How many of these people are in the public school system? And I've got Chris on the telephone. Chris is a school teacher here in Eastern North Carolina. I'm not going to say where he's a school teacher. He might not want me to say. And I don't know what he's going to tell us, but he's dialing in to respond to this James Ford nonsense. Good morning, Chris. How are you?
Good morning. I'm well. How are you, sir?
You teach in the North Carolina public school system. You don't have to say where.
Yes, I do.
Are you high school, middle school?
I teach high school American history.
Okay.
And I can tell you that we are seeing the effects of people like this coming through in the curriculum. Now, I will kind of politely correct a caller a little bit ago. We do include American history starts with colonization, then goes through the American Revolution. And
yeah, we had a caller from, was it Newbern, I believe? Aubrey said that they start American history teaching now in 1867. Someone else pointed out on one of our media feeds here that that is incorrect, so that you do start with the Revolutionary War and all that?
Yes, sir. So it starts with like Columbus and colonization.
Okay.
Goes to the end of Reconstruction. That's in American History 1. Then American History 2 starts in 1877 and goes through about 2010-ish.
I got you. So that's probably what Aubrey was thinking. He was thinking about the second level of history.
But well, yeah. Well, what's happening is that's the current essential standards for the state. They have just decided to change the North Carolina essential standards for social studies, and they are going to compact both of American History 1 and American History 2, including all the years I just named, into one semester. So they are, if you come to high school, you've got 8 semesters total. Out of 8 semesters in high school, you are going to get one semester of American history. So even though it is still on paper, including the revolution up through 2010, I believe, I'm just here to tell you that that volume of content crammed into one semester for high school kids, you know, we're not talking college kids. That's borderline impossible to teach it well. Now, here's just a quick, and I'll get off, but a quick story about the new standards. They sent a survey out to all the teachers in North Carolina about how we felt about the new standards. And it was, you know, online, of course, and you can click through. After each new standard, there's a little drop-down box with one lone yes or no question. And the question was this: do you agree that this standard is culturally sensitive? No question about whether or not you agree. Hey, should something else be included? Do you think that this should not be included? Do you think this standard is clear? Nothing like that. The only question for every single standard, yes or no, do you agree that this is culturally sensitive?
Well, you know, the thing about that.
Here comes the principal.
Are you in trouble?
Maybe.
Are you getting called to the principal's office?
But
is it time for you to teach?
I emailed everybody up in Raleigh about that. I sent a ton of emails. I emailed all these board members and people in charge of social studies curriculum.
Yeah.
I got no responses from. I got a few automated responses from board members. I'm out of the office until Tuesday of next week. That kind of thing.
Yeah.
Never got a single answer.
Well, you know, here's the thing. We can change the way that we teach. There's a lot of arguments about the techniques of teaching, like Common Core and right. You know, the way things have changed. But you know, I don't care what you say. What you're going to leave out. What you're going to add, whether it's culturally sensitive or not, history is history.
That's what I mean.
You can't change history. It is what it is, right?
That's right. But what they can do is do something like what they've done and crush it all into one semester so that we can no longer teach it effectively. And
you think that's the goal? They did away with the History 1 and History 2, so it's all put in one semester and you can kind of glaze over stuff that they don't want the kids to really hear about from the history?
I think so. You know, every year I tell kids, not because I believe this for a second, but I tell kids, hey, just for the purpose of scoring well on this state exam, remember, if you're not sure which answer to pick, go with the one that makes the United States look the worst. And I guarantee you that will be the right answer.
Isn't that sad?
You know what? I have good test scores every year. How scary is that?
That's ridiculous. But,
thank you for taking my call.
Yeah, thank you, Chris.
I have to run to my virtual classroom here.
All right, go. Don't get in trouble with the principal. See you later. Chris, school teacher here, history, high school history teacher. This is the end of public schools as we know it.
Stop. I know.
This is what your kids are being taught in school. You have to pay attention to what is happening to your kids. Just got the Vidant health numbers. Let's see. On Friday, there were 45 hospitalizations in Greenville. Today, there are only 44. But there are three more people in ICU. There were 7 on Friday, 10 on 10 today in ICU in Greenville. Total hospitalizations, 84 across the entire nine-county Vidant health system on Friday, 84. Today, there are 82. So the numbers are hanging in about the same. Has there been one single case of an ECU student go to the
hospital? Not that I've seen. No.
We haven't heard of one case of an ECU student. Now, I've heard of cases of kids getting sick.
I haven't heard of any case of a college student at any at ECU, Carolina State, UNC Charlotte, at any of them having to go to the hospital.
I haven't either. It doesn't affect the young that way. It's the older folks.
And people keep saying, "Well, you know, how sick are these kids?" Well, you know, you're not going to know that. They're not going to be able to.
I got some information. Some off the record kind of information. I'm not going to call any names, but I asked that question: are these kids getting sick? And the answer was no.
Well, that's what I'm hearing,
too. But there's a varying level of the way it affects people. Some of them are having headaches. Some of them have fever. Some of them are just feeling bad. Some of them don't even know they've got it. But they go get tested because of the contact tracing.
Right.
And, boom, they've got it. And they didn't even know they had it. So that's the way it's affecting college kids. But, the shutting down the classes at ECU, man, it's just such a blow to our economy. Such a blow to the to the Greenville economy. It's just going to hurt again.
You know, I was out and about Saturday uptown, had to work, and I was amazed and pleasantly surprised at the amount of foot traffic I saw from students in the uptown area here on Saturday. I mean, people were out eating, they were shopping, they were walking around, and I was like, this is what I think uptown is always. Is what people always envisioned uptown to be on a weekend to see this student. Now, I know the apartment complexes and things have helped with that, having those in close proximity. But, you know, to see that was such a good sign for the economy and certainly a great sign for uptown Greenville and Greenville as a whole. And now you wonder after this, you know, will students stay on campus? Will they go back home? What's going to happen? And you're right. It's a huge blow. And you hate to see it. And you hate to think about what's going to happen with businesses now here locally.
By the way, my source is telling me that over the weekend, that because of the students and the explosion in cases at ECU, that the cases in Pitt County were up 266 cases. We also had one death over the weekend, which it was, are we at double digit deaths yet in Pitt County?
Yeah, we are. I don't know the exact number, but it's up. And you got to think that number.
But I mean, 266 cases over the weekend, most of them students.
Well, think about how that's impacting the entire numbers we're seeing statewide. If you look at
but that's why the chancellor had to shut the classes down. That's why he had to shut them down. Because I mean, if you go back 72 hours ago, he was with us at Great Harvest Bread Company, and you tell me, you were there with us. He had no intentions of shutting classes down Friday morning.
I did not get that impression,
There was just an explosion of cases over the weekend that just happened like that, probably as a result of the all the partying the week before.
15 deaths, by the way. But, yeah, you're right. I didn't get that sense either.
A couple other interesting stories here in Pitt County over the weekend. How about the ECU student who was interning, law enforcement student, kid from Hertford, was interning. Michael Stephen Higgins, 22-year-old ECU student, senior at ECU, participating in the Patrol's college internship program, killed when the patrolman crashed chasing someone. Now, the patrolman didn't get hurt badly, my understanding. He was riding with the highway patrolman. Patrolman lost in a high-speed chase.
I believe it was an intoxicated driver is what the report I saw was.
Lost control of his car and
hit a pole.
Hit a pole, and this kid's dead today. Our thoughts and prayers go out to the family up there in Hertford, Perquimans County. That's a terrible story, and, you know, you got to wonder if that's the last we've heard of that.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I could certainly end that.
Yeah. And then there was interesting last night off of Fire Tower Road at Summer Haven Drive. What is the story on this?
You know,
this guy was murdered in his front yard?
Well, I didn't even know he was murdered in his front yard.
I got a little inside information on this, and apparently this happened out in the guy's front yard or in someone's front yard.
Okay.
There was someone murdered right there off Fire Tower Road. This is not an area of town that we see murders.
No, somewhere Haven Drive, and yeah.
Police department says more details will be released today. No names have been released. But it was a homicide right there, kind of right there near Covenant Church.
Yep.
Where you turn to go to Boyd Lee Park there on Corey Road in that area. Really, that's extremely unusual for that part of town.
Other side of the road, I guess, if you're traveling west.
Yeah. Already seeing protesters in Charlotte for the Republican National Convention. There were some protesters Saturday night that surrounded a car. Remember last week we saw the guy get pulled out of his truck and beaten in Oakland?
Mm-hmm.
In Portland.
Portland, yeah.
So this person had to be frightened to death. These protesters went to an intersection in downtown Charlotte and surrounded the car. Thank God the police showed up. And they were arrested. The protesters were arrested. But hang on to your hat for some of that stuff to be happening this week in Charlotte. North Carolina has approved the $300 per week unemployment benefits from FEMA. That happened on Friday. So if you're out of work, help is on the way through unemployment. The Federal Emergency Management Agency announced Friday afternoon that North Carolina becomes one of 15 states that have had their applications approved for their share of that federal fund that's going to go to unemployment benefits, which is capped at $44 billion. So Roy Cooper did the right thing and applied for it. Otherwise, he might have gotten shut out because it's capped at $44 billion and there are already 15 states that have gotten it. This is interesting. Over the weekend, did you see the sister of Donald Trump? They released some audio tapes from Trump's niece that wrote the scathing book about him. She would never say where she got her information about Trump hiring someone to take his SATs. But now it appears that information came from his sister, who apparently, there's some real drama in this family. Mary Trump, the president's niece, said that, she would never say where she got the information, but now some tapes have surfaced where Marianne Trump, Trump's older sister, who, by the way, retired last year as a federal judge, apparently said some really nasty things about her brother. And by the way, she didn't show up at her other brother's funeral over the weekend, if that tells you anything. Mark Meadows was on some of the shows yesterday, some of the Sunday morning shows. He says, I can tell you I've never met the judge. I was at the funeral the other day. I was hoping to meet her, but she didn't show up for her own brother's funeral. Apparently, she said some really nasty things that I'm not even going to quote because it's got a lot of expletives in it. But this is the kind of stuff you expect to surface here right before the election. There'll be more of this. Just hang on for it. Let's see. There's a guy in Russia, Alexei Navalny, who has been blogging about Putin for years. This is what happens to you when you blog negative stuff about Vladimir Putin. He's got a blog, and he's been blogging stuff about Vladimir Putin for many, many years. And, of course, he's been threatened many times from the authorities in Moscow, you better cut this out. So over the weekend, he fell ill aboard a plane which made an emergency landing. His press secretary says Navalny was poisoned on the plane. He is now comatose in a Siberian hospital.
Jeez.
So this is what happens to you when you criticize Vladimir Putin. You end up comatose in a Siberian hospital. speculation was that he may have chosen the wrong drink on the plane when the flight attendant came by. Can I get you something to drink, sir? Oh, you really don't want that. How about this? Mm.
That's awful.
Vladimir has sent you a special, special gift. So, no more Alexei Navalny blogs about Vladimir Putin. 25 after. Let's get a break in. We're coming back. More Talk of the Town here for Monday morning. Stay with us. We got more right after this.
Top Dog Academy is Eastern North Carolina's complete dog training facility. Top Dog provides an excellent environment for dogs of all ages with training services and workweek daycare. Top Dog is located on Highway 43 South, just 4 miles from Bells Fork, and features a comfortable, healthy environment and a spacious facility for daycare and a brand new, beautiful facility for training. Call 752-8215 or visit topdogonline.com.
Come on out Highway 43 South to Top Dog Academy, where we know dogs.
My name is Dr. Neeti Armistead, Chief Medical Officer for Vidant Health. The following simple steps will help keep you and your community safe. Stay home as much as possible, wear a mask when out in public, avoid large gatherings, practice social distancing, and wash hands often. It's also important not to delay needed care. Vidant has taken important steps to provide you and your family with a safe environment. Learn more about COVID-19 and Vidant's response. Call 252-847-8000 or visit vidanthealth.com/COVID-19.
Mom, I'm so bored.
The most music for your workday with Mark, and Laura, Beth McCall, and Dylan McKay.
The most music for your workday plays here.
That she was up for adoption, she was dead set on, no, I need to just be realistic about my life and what my future holds.
That's when she came to me and she said, would you be interested in us adopting you? I didn't think that I would have a family again. I didn't think that I would go to college. I didn't think that I would have love. And with that, I just feel like my world is just so much brighter.
Sexy and I know it. Girl, look at that body.
The information you want when you need it. This is your Talk of the Town news update.
Good morning. I'm Trent McGee. This news update comes your way at 28 past the hour. East Carolina University will move undergraduate courses online for the remainder of the fall semester beginning Wednesday, August 26th. Undergraduate classes are suspended today and Tuesday while students and faculty adjust to the change in the semester schedule. University residence halls will begin move out this week with the conclusion on August 30th. All this recording, according to an ECU media release on Sunday. The university will work with international students, student athletes, and hardship cases who apply to continue to live on campus. ECU Interim Chancellor Dr. Ron Mitchelson says they plan to move forward with all sports, including ECU season opener against Marshall on September 12th. Football opener, that is. Tailgating, though, will be banned on ECU property. Greenville police are investigating a homicide on Sunday on Summerhaven Drive in Greenville. The department reported the incident around 4:45. It said one person was dead and one person was detained. Additional information expected to be released later today. The Republican National Convention gets underway today in Charlotte. The event will be mostly conducted remotely and streamed online, although there is also will be a reduced in-person portion of the event. There will be plenty of speakers, including First Lady Melania Trump, who will speak on Tuesday from the newly renovated Rose Garden. Vice President Mike Pence will address the nation on Wednesday, and President Donald Trump will officially accept his party's nomination on Thursday night. What is now Tropical Storm Laura could impact the Triangle later this week. The latest model from the Storm Prediction Center is forecasting Laura will be a Category 2 hurricane when it makes landfall between Houston and New Orleans on Wednesday. The storm will then make a northeastern turn and move through parts of Arkansas, Mississippi, Tennessee, and finally North Carolina by Friday. And the latest figures released by the North Carolina Department, or Division that is, of Employment Security showed an 8.5% unemployment rate during the month of July. That translated into 72,000 people returning to workforce last month, but the numbers were offset by the more than 135,000 workers who lost their jobs last month, bringing the total number of unemployed in the state to 4.9 million. With your Talk of the Town news update, I'm Trent McGee.
All right, very good. Let's check our weather update this morning, brought to you by Country Mart Stores here in Eastern North Carolina. First of all, we've got a 40% chance of rain today and 87 degrees for a high. On Tuesday, pretty much identical, 88 for a high and a 40% chance of rain. No chance of rain on Wednesday, and it gets back in the 90s again, about 91. And as we look toward the weekend, probably has a lot to do with those storms and where they come. One of them is kind of twisting back toward us. The other one's going out toward Houston, but they're both going to the Gulf.
Could put have some impacts on the Triangle and, of course, Eastern North Carolina come late Friday.
Boy, don't you know the people in New Orleans right now are a little nervous, don't you think? News and weather, a service of our friends Smitty at Country Mart Stores, our good friend Ken Smith. Of course, Country Mart with two locations in Greenville. I mean, in Pitt County and Stokes, and one just outside Greenville on Highway 11. And, of course, Highway 11 has the great restaurant Smitty's. If you've never been to Smitty's restaurant, great country cooking every day for lunch and great biscuits and breakfast right there, cooked to order. They cook it right in front of you, bring it out to your table. It is absolutely fantastic. If you've never been to Smitty's, you need to check it out. And, of course, don't forget that Shell Gas is now available. You can get a lot of rewards if you get that Shell Rewards gas card from Country Mart and save a lot of money on gas. And, of course, as always, Country Mart's still the only place in Pitt County where you can get that 93-octane ethanol-free gas. That's what you need to put in your boat and your lawnmower. Keep those engines safe. Country Mart stores, 903 and Stokes and Highway 11 just outside Greenville between Greenville and Bethel. 832 right now, 28 in front of 9 o'clock. Stand by. We're going to talk to an old friend in Washington's who's going to give us a little information about how to honor the late mayor of Washington, Bear Hodges. So stand by for that coming up next.
The trade-in deals are hot at Greenville Toyota. We're cutting checks on the spot for trades and giving you up to 130% of book value. That means if it's worth 10 grand, we'll give you 13. Rush to Greenville Toyota.
Top Dog Academy provides training services and daycare for dog owners in and around Greenville. The Top Dog facility, located on Highway 43 South, just 4 miles from Bellsport, is a comfortable, healthy environment where dog owners can feel secure about leaving their pets. Top Dog Academy teaches people how to have a better relationship with their dog. Call 752-8215 or visit topdogonline.com.
Come on out Highway 43 South to Top Dog Academy, where we know dogs.
My name is Dr. Neeti Armistead, Chief Medical Officer for Vidant Health. The following simple steps will help keep you and your community safe. Stay home as much as possible, wear a mask when out in public, avoid large gatherings, practice social distancing, and wash hands often. It's also important not to delay needed care. Vidant has taken important steps to provide you and your family with a safe environment. Learn more about COVID-19 and Vidant's response. Call 252-847-8000 or visit vidanthealth.com/COVID-19.
Freshwater wetlands cover only 1% of the Earth's surface, but provide habitat for 12% of all animals. Why are wetlands such good homes? The plants, water, and soils of wetlands provide food and homes for mammals, birds, fish, and more. Sadly, wetlands are at risk, and that puts wildlife at risk too. To find out more about wetlands and how you can help, visit ducks.org.
While consumer use of electronics continues to grow, the environmental footprint continues to shrink thanks to lighter, less material-intensive, and more energy-efficient products. The Consumer Technology Association and its members want to help minimize environmental impacts by making recycling old tech devices as easy as buying new ones. Your old TV, smartphone, or computer can give new life to new products. Go to greenergadgets.org, put in your zip code, and find convenient drop-off locations. Live green, buy green, and recycle responsibly at greenergadgets.org.
The deals are hot now at Greenville Toyota. Get a 2020 Corolla now under 17 grand. Plus, get no charge lifetime maintenance included with every purchase. That's the Greenville Advantage. Greenville Toyota, where our volume saves you money.
Hottest topics of summer.
BLM.
Every day.
Statues coming down.
Riots and the protests.
Hear about it here with Henry Hinton and Talk of the Town on Talk 96.3 and 103.7.
All right, 836, 24 in front of 9 o'clock. And we, of course, lost Mac Bear Hodges, the Bear, we all knew him as. You know, before he was mayor, I'm not even sure I knew his real name. But Mac Hodges, of course, was on the ventilator at Vidant Medical Center for, I think, about 12 days, something like that, and then they had trouble getting him off and getting him to breathe on his own, and so he passed away, which was very tragic for all of us who knew and loved Bear. And folks in Washington certainly had a lot of respect for him and loved him. And our friend Jim Buckman joins me on the telephone right now. Jim is a longtime businessman, an old friend in Washington. Good morning, Jim. How are you?
Good morning, Henry. How are you?
Doing good. Let's talk about Bear a little bit before we talk about what the I know that you and others are putting together an endowment for him, and we want to give people information about that. But you know, when you're in politics, people either love you or hate you most of the time. But you know, I find it hard to believe that anybody over there in Washington didn't really like Mac Hodges.
I was telling somebody just a couple of days ago. In fact, I mentioned this to Lou, Mac's wife. My entire life, I've known Mac all my life. I have never heard a single person make a negative comment about Mac.
Yeah.
And if you can go through life, almost 70 years in his case, and have people say that, then you've done a lot of things right.
Well, I've lost two friends in the last 10 days, Mac and then my friend Philip Horn, which I said the same thing about Philip. You know, no one ever said anything bad about Philip Horn. He was just an ace, and so was Bear. But then Bear got into politics. You know, I was surprised when Bear got into politics.
I was really shocked.
Yeah, tell that story. How did that happen?
But I'm gonna tell you, he really embraced it.
Yeah.
I mean, he studied it. He wanted to do right for our little town. In fact, he and I made a trip, maybe about 6 weeks to Greenville in an attempt to entice another little community bank to move here. So he was extremely involved in trying to get industry to move in, to create jobs, to revitalize our downtown. He just really committed to it.
And, you know, there's a project going on downtown right now. Of course, Washington's always had a neat downtown area. The economy has hit it over the years, of course, like it has a lot of small communities. But you guys have that great waterscape there, right there on the Pamlico River. That you have an asset that a lot of folks don't have. But there's a project going on right now to upgrade the streets in downtown Washington.
There's a beautification project going on Main Street. And part of that, Mac wanted to, you know, for years and years, we had the Stewart Parkway, which, you know, runs parallel to the river.
Right.
And we never took full advantage like some other eastern North Carolina coastal towns. And so he realized the asset that we had and wanted to entice these businesses and investors to come in and open that up and take advantage of the waterfront. And we're in the midst of doing that right now. It's just a shame that he's not going to be able to see it through fruition.
Yeah, it's too bad.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've always said that about Washington. You've got an asset there that probably has not been fully taken advantage of over the years. So God bless Mac for having that vision and others.
Yes.
Jim Buckman, who's a close friend of Mayor Mac Hodges. Now, as I understand it, we may get a new mayor this week. Is that what you've been told?
That's where I'm here, and I think the council is going to meet probably tonight and make that decision on who the new mayor will be.
Mm-hmm. You got any guesses?
I don't. Okay. I don't. Mac tried for years and years and years. See, my office, Henry, I rent my office from Mac. I am right across the hall from where Mac was. Mac lives upstairs in a building that faces the waterfront here.
Yeah, he's always been on the water down there.
Yeah, so I'd see Mac every single day. And so as a result, when all this happened, Phil Edwards, another really close, lifelong friend. In fact, I was trying to get him connected with us this morning, but I'm not the most technologically savvy person, so I didn't have any luck. But Phil and I started discussing it. And so we called Matt Maloney, big guy, and Mark Hussert and said, hey, we want to do something for him. And they suggested that we look into the endowment program. And so that's how this got off the ground. And we're doing pretty well with it. Obviously, we need all the help we can get from everybody, because to do the full endowment, we need $30,000.
So this is going to be an endowment in the name of Mac Hodges at ECU.
At ECU. He will be on the endowment wall. His facial image will go up there with all the other endowment donors. And we couldn't have, you know, as much as Mac loved, he probably exposed more people to ECU athletics than any person I've ever known.
I mean, you always knew if Mac was there because you could see that purple and gold van, or he used to have an old purple and gold. Was it a Pontiac? What was it?
Yeah, it's just an old minivan. He painted up purple and gold.
Yeah.
And you could see him coming a mile away. And most of the time, he'd have that van loaded with people headed to a ball game.
I know it. I always love seeing Mac at the ball games. All right. So the Mac Hodges Endowment at ECU has been established. How do people contribute?
People would make a check payable to the ECU Educational Foundation. And in the bottom memo section, they would indicate the Mac Hodges Endowment. They can either send that directly to the Pirate Club at the Ward Sports Medicine Building in Greenville, or they could contact myself, Jim Buckman, at 252-946-0551, or they could call Phil Edwards at 252-945-6286. And any of us would be glad to provide the details.
Is all that information online somewhere, Jim, that we can share it on Facebook and get it?
I don't know, but I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll go to work on that today.
Yeah, let me know.
And try to get that done.
If you will send me a link through my email, I'll make sure it gets on all of our Facebook pages.
That would be great.
We reach about 120,000 people just through Facebook, believe it or not, with all our Facebook pages.
Wonderful. And we need all the exposure we can get.
Yeah.
I know Mike is really going to be really appreciative of the effort here, and I can't think of anything better that we could do to recognize him at the university that he loves so dear.
Yeah. Well, Jim, you're a good friend to do this. I know you love Mac. We all did. Just tragic to lose him, and I appreciate the efforts that you are putting forth here on that for Bear. And I hope that a lot of people will contribute. I certainly am going to contribute once you send me the link, and I hope others will as well. And we appreciate you taking the time to do this and to be on to tell us about it today.
Thank you so much. Look forward to seeing you soon.
Okay, Jim. Jim Buckman, who is an investment guy there in Washington. And Jim's a good guy. I've known him since – I think Jim and I were probably in college together at ECU, but good friends with Mac. And so this is a really nice thing. I hope people will contribute. And, you know, by the way, there's also a scholarship that's been founded in Philip Horn's name at the UNC School of the Arts, or you can make a donation to the to the Thomas Harriet Arts Council here in Greenville at ECU, because Philip was on that board as well. Mm-hmm. He was on the Thomas Harriet board here at ECU, but he was also on the Board of Trustees at the UNC School of the Arts. People may not know this about Philip Horn. I know we're talking about Mac, but Philip actually produced a film that ended up on HBO years ago. He was the producer of that film. And he had an interesting background. He loved film. It wasn't what he ended up doing as a vocation. I think if he had his druthers, he would have. But that's a hard industry to break sure. into when you come from Northampton County.
Wait a minute. That's supposed to be.
Or you come from any county in North Carolina. We're not exactly the film capital of the world. Although I will say that I got a great call from Beth Grant, who, of course, is we've been talking about famous ECU alums. We talked about today being Vince McMahon's 75th birthday. And is he or Sandra Bullock the most recognized ECU alum? And you think it's Vince McMahon. I think there's an argument it could be Sandra Bullock.
Well, I think it depends on who you ask, too. But I think
there's no doubt he has more money.
Well, I think different alum resonate with the different generations of students and graduates of the university. And for you, it would be someone different. I think for now, though, Vince McMahon is still such a very popular name, and people recognize his face. And so I think for now, for the students, it would be Vince McMahon.
You think
McMahon.
He's more recognizable than Sandra Bullock?
I think for the students there right now, yes. Now, in my generation, Sandra Bullock, it was it, no doubt about it. And I knew who Beth Grant was.
Yeah.
But not everyone did, but Sandra Bullock for me.
Well, anyway, Beth Grant, of course, is for those of you who don't know, she's actually a personal friend of mine. But she and Philip and I became really good friends. In fact, I remember we had dinner with her and some other folks in Hollywood. We were talking about that. Beth called me on Friday morning when she heard the news about Philip, or maybe Thursday morning. And of course, Beth has a new movie coming out that she told me was just shot in Wilmington. And I'm like, you were here and didn't call me? She says, well, I thought about calling you and asking you to be an extra in the movie. She said, but you'd have been working all day for nothing, and you'd have probably got left on the cutting room floor. I was like, yeah, you're right. I wouldn't have done that. But her brother Bubba did it. Bubba actually went down and was an extra in the movie. The name of her new movie is Words on Bathroom Walls, and it's getting released. It's going to be a pretty big movie, I think. Of course, Beth's been in so many Academy Award-nominated movies. Speed. She was in Speed with Sandra Bullock. She was in No Country for Old Men. She was in Little Miss Sunshine. Mm-hmm. She was in Rain Man. She's just been she's been in all these movies. But she was devastated to hear the news about Philip Horn as well. And we had some Philip and Beth and I actually had some good times together. So we were reminiscing about that over the weekend. Love Beth very much, Beth Grant. And I'm looking forward to her new movie, Words on Bathroom Walls. She plays a nun. I was like, oh, my God, that's so far from reality. 848, got a message, speaking of ECU, got a message from a parent here on Facebook this morning. I thought this was kind of interesting. It says, so sad for ECU and other university students that had to move out of the dorms. A lot of hardship for many parents. What's the actual percentage of students at ECU that tested positive? You may have discussed this, but I hadn't tuned in earlier. I don't know the answer to that, but there's no doubt it was an explosion over the weekend. We're told that over the weekend, 266 people tested positive in Pitt County. Now, they weren't all on campus, but I mentioned earlier how many of these ECU students living in other student housing, not on campus, there may be your answer. Because I'm told that just about all of these 266 cases were ECU students. So, and that was just over the weekend. So you ask what percentage, there are 29,000 students. So, is that 1%? So, but, you know, it was spreading. I mean, and, you know, I'm not going to criticize Dr. Mitchelson or the administration, because here's the thing. We talked about this Friday morning with Ron. There were already these protesters saying, you should shut this down, and you've got liability. You have one college student that dies from this, which, again, we mentioned most of them are even asymptomatic and just getting a little bit sick with headaches and fever at that age. But if you have something really bad happen, it opens up the university for major legal problems, I would think.
And yeah, so, I would too.
You know, he did the right thing. As sad as it is, you know, and but no tailgating, he said yesterday. But we are going to play football on September
12th. No tailgating on ECU property.
No tailgating on ECU property. So there'll probably be some.
I expect there'll be some in other places. I do. Yeah. Don't you?
Yeah. My guess is stadium sports parking lot will probably be pretty full.
Yeah, I mean,
Eric might like that. 10 minutes in front of 9. We'll be right back.
Hot now at Greenville Toyota. Get a 2020 Corolla now under 17 grand. Plus, get no charge lifetime maintenance included with every purchase. That's the Greenville Advantage. Greenville Toyota, where our volume saves you money.
I'm sexy and I know it.
Top Dog Academy is Eastern North Carolina's complete dog training facility. Top Dog provides an excellent environment for dogs of all ages with training services and workweek daycare. Top Dog is located on Highway 43 South, just 4 miles from Bells Fork, and features a comfortable, healthy environment and a spacious facility for daycare and a brand new, beautiful facility for training. Call 752-8215 or visit topdogonline.com.
Come on out Highway 43 South to Top Dog Academy, where we know dogs.
My name is Dr. Neeti Armistead, Chief Medical Officer for Vidant Health. The following simple steps will help keep you and your community safe. Stay home as much as possible, wear a mask when out in public, avoid large gatherings, practice social distancing, and wash hands often. It's also important not to delay needed care. Vidant has taken important steps to provide you and your family with a safe environment. Learn more about COVID-19 and Vidant's response. Call 252-847-8000 or visit vidanthealth.com/COVID-19.
Mom, I'm so bored.
The most music for your workday with Mark, Mark, and Laura, Beth McCall, and Dylan McKay.
The most music for your workday plays here.
Trade-in deals are hot at Greenville Toyota. Hot, hot, hot. We're cutting checks on the spot for trades and giving you up to 130% of book value. That means if it's worth 10 grand, we'll give you 13. Rush to Greenville Toyota.
Of the Town with Henry Hinton.
He's kind of a diva.
He's absolutely fascinating.
Ultimate gentleman spy. Irresistible to women, deadly to his enemies, a legend in his own time.
You won't believe what he's going to say next on Talk 96.3 and 103.7.
Hey, Talk of the Town this morning brought to you in part by the Tire Realty Group and Property Management Team. They got their TRG Offers program going where you can actually get an offer on your home without ever showing it to anyone. How about that? You can do it over the phone. They've got it going on. The real estate market is red. You know, some of the businesses aren't doing good. Real estate's doing great. Down at the beach this weekend, they're selling real estate like crazy down there. And, of course, Homer's getting it done here in Greenville. Homer and Rachel and their team of agents continue to sell something like one. They average one home sold every 24 hours. So if you want to list it, sell it, and move on, give the Tire Realty Group a call today, 252-758-4663. That's 758-HOME. Or you can visit them online at tirerealtygroup.com. That's T-Y-R-E. If I was going to sell my home today, I'd be calling 758-HOME for the Tire Realty Group. All right, we're going to redo the laugh track here in a minute, but first, our pirate report this hour. And our Pirate Report this hour brought to you by Greenville Marine Outdoor Shop in Greenville. And here is McGee with our Pirate Report.
All right, ECU still planning to have its season opener versus Marshall on September 12th at Dowdy Ficklin Stadium. No tailgating will be allowed on ECU property. No game time yet has been announced for that game either. A firm decision on fan participation has not been made, but I'm sure will be coming soon. Football activities were paused last Thursday. The Pirates normally have Mondays off. Hopefully we'll be back on the field at some point, either maybe tomorrow or Wednesday, but no official word yet on when they're going to return to the practice field. And in other sports, Takuma Soto won the Indianapolis 500. Kevin Harvick winner in the Dover International Speedway there. And Dustin Johnson won the Northern Trust Open by 13 shots. The largest, wow. I'm sorry, by 11 shots, the largest margin of victory since Phil Mickelson did one by 13 in 2006.
How about that?
30 under.
Yeah, that's crazy. All right, that's our Pirate Report brought to you this morning by Greenville Marine and Outdoor Shop. Whether you need hunting, fishing, or just boating accessories, clothing, or other supplies, make Greenville Marine Outdoor Shop your one-stop destination. And now I blew through the time. We can redo the Gavigan last track. Sorry about that. Can't get Jim Gaffigan on this hour. Let me see. A couple of program notes. We mentioned we're going to be live in Beaufort Wednesday morning. The Republican House Whip for Congress, Steve Scalise, is scheduled to be in Eastern North Carolina. Now, I will tell you that we have learned that congressman will not be with us live Thursday morning at the Beaufort Hotel, but we're going to be at the Beaufort Hotel, and Michael's going to come down. We're going to tape an interview with him Wednesday night, but he's got to leave Wednesday night. We're hoping to get some of the other Congress people that are going to be gathered there at the Beaufort Hotel. We'll tell you more about that. We'll have more details tomorrow. But Steve Scalise will be on the show on Thursday, and we'll be live in Beaufort, so come see us. We'll see you tomorrow.
The trade-in deals are hot at Greenville Toyota. Hot, hot, hot. We're cutting checks on the spot for trades and giving you up to 130% of book value. That means if it's worth 10 grand, we'll give you 13. Rush to Greenville Toyota.
Top Dog Academy is Eastern North Carolina's complete dog training facility. Top Dog provides an excellent environment for dogs of all ages with training services and workweek daycare. Top Dog is located on Highway 43 South, just 4 miles from Bells Fork, and features a comfortable, healthy environment and a spacious facility for daycare and a brand new, beautiful facility for training. Call 752-8215 or visit topdogonline.com.
Come on out Highway 43 South to Top Dog Academy, where we know dogs.
Workday with Mark, Mark, and Laura, Beth McCall, and Dylan McKay.
The most music for your day plays here.
My name is Dr. Neeti Armistead, Chief Medical Officer for Vidant Health. The following simple steps will help keep you and your community safe. Stay home as much as possible, wear a mask when out in public, avoid large gatherings, practice social distancing, and wash hands often. It's also important not to delay needed care. Vidant has taken important steps to provide you and your family with a safe environment. Learn more about COVID-19 and Vidant's response. Call 252-847-8000 or visit vidanthealth.com/COVID-19.
I'm sexy and I know it.
The deals are hot now at Greenville Toyota. Hot, hot, hot.
Get a 2020 Corolla now under 17 grand. Plus, get no charge lifetime maintenance included with every purchase. That's the Greenville Advantage. Greenville Toyota, where our volume saves you money.